वेलकम ऑल द्वितीय ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम। आई डॉक्टर सस्मिता महापात्र, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स एंड कम्युनिकेशन इंजीनियरिंग ऑफ सर एम विश्वेश्वरैया इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी। आई एम गोइंग टू टेक मॉड्यूल 2 ऑफ माइक्रोवेव एंड एंटेनास, व्हिच इज अ प्रिस्क्राइब्ड सब्जेक्ट फॉर बीई इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स एंड कम्युनिकेशन एंड टेलीकम्युनिकेशन स्टूडेंट्स। In this module 2, we'll be dealing with two parts. One is a microwave network theory, and the other one is microwave passive devices. So coming for the first part, microwave network theory. The topics to be covered are introduction to microwave networks, symmetrical Z and Y parameters for reciprocal network, S-matrix representation of multiport network, properties of S-matrix, comparison between S, Z, and Y matrices. So, starting with the topics, introduction to normal network. Now, why do you want introduction to a normal network before going to microwave network? Because there are certain differences between a normal network and a microwave network. As we know, in any network, whenever we are going to do any connections, we need a source. So in a normal network, we have the source which is capable of producing a signal of few hertz of frequency. It can be hundreds of hertz or certain times kilohertz frequency. Now, in addition to that, what we have in the network, we have certain active devices, we have passive devices, then interconnected with a connecting wire, we can have the complete network structure. Now, this network can be denoted as a two-port network where we have two ports. One side is for the input port and the other side for the output port. Now, usually in such kind of networks, we have seen that we deal with voltage and current. What are the input port and output port? We are sometimes going to measure the input voltage, output voltage, or input current and output current. Now, while doing all these things, when we go for a two-port network, so basically while finding out the relationship between the input port parameters and the output port parameters, we use certain parameters, something like Z parameter, Y parameter, H parameter, and ABCD parameters. Now, what does these parameters do? Usually, we have seen that while finding out these parameters, either we have to open circuit one port or we have to short circuit one port. So in order to find the voltage and current accordingly, either we go for these two, and then we have a relationship between the voltage and current. In Z parameters, when we are using the Z parameters, we get the relationship between the input voltage, suppose V1. So V1 can be written as Z11 I1, where I1 is the input port current, plus Z12 I2, where I2 is the output port current. Similarly, V2, the output port voltage can be written as Z21 into I1 plus Z22 into I2. So this Z parameter is also known as impedance parameter, which gives us the impedance at the input side as well as at the output side. Coming for the next parameter, this is basically Y parameter, also known as admittance. So here also, using the Y parameter, similarly, we can get a relationship between the current and voltage, both at the input port and at the output port. Similarly, we have H parameters, hybrid parameters. Now, why we call it is a hybrid parameter? Because in this parameters, sometimes we have it in terms of impedance, sometimes we have the parameter in terms of admittance, sometimes it is in terms of voltage gain, and sometimes it is in terms of current gain. So because of the mixture of all these parameters, usually it is known as one hybrid parameter. Same way, we have the next analysis can be done using ABCD parameters. So this Z, Y, H, and ABCD parameters basically are used for the analysis of a two-port network, where we have the variables are in terms of current and voltage. But if we are going for microwave signal or electromagnetic spectrum, we can see that the electromagnetic spectrum has variable frequency. The frequency varies for a spectrum. Starting from a low frequency, it can go up to a very high frequency. Now, depending on the frequency, it has different applications. When the frequency is in the range of certain megahertz or kilohertz, we call it as a radio frequency signal, usually used for radio and your TV communication, something like that. But when it comes to a higher frequency, like in the gigahertz range, we call it as a microwave. We don't call it as a normal signal, rather we call it as a microwave. So it has its own application. Similarly, when the frequency goes on increasing, so the applications are going to be different. Now, when we are talking a microwave network, this microwave network is going to deal with the source which can generate or which is capable of generating this high frequency signal, which is in the form or which is in the terms of gigahertz range. So obviously, the source that we are going to use here is not just a signal generator as we are using in a normal network. Rather, it is a microwave source. So it can be a reflex klystron, magnetron, traveling wave tube, or backward wave oscillator. The source can be anything. Now, once the signal is generated, once the microwave signal or microwave is generated, so which is of very high frequency, now coming further, this wave has to be carried through a transmission line. Now you would have seen in analog circuit lab, when you have entered the lab, you have done the experiments, you are connecting the devices and the from the source where you get the signal, in between them you have some connecting wires. But when we come for a microwave network, remember, we cannot just connect it using normal connecting wires. Rather, the transmission lines which are used for a microwave networks are also going to change. So we can have transmission lines which are waveguides or coaxial cables. Now, what is one waveguide? Already you know this, but still I want to show. So this is a waveguide that you can see. Now in this waveguide, what you have or how we can explain this waveguide. So once the wave is propagating, so it is going through from one port to the other port. Okay. Now this waveguide, when we excite the waveguide, when we send the signal, usually we give it at one end. So this I can take it as one end of the waveguide. Now here we can have excited the source, whatever the signal is generated, wave is generated, it is going to excited here. It is going to be excited here. Now through this rectangular waveguide, why it is called a rectangular waveguide, you can see the cross-sectional structure here. You have x-axis, y-axis. This gives you a cross-sectional structure of a rectangular. Rectangle. Now through this waveguide, through this length of the waveguide, the wave is going to propagate. Now how the wave is going to be propagated? Once the signal is excited, it's going to fall on one of the wall of the rectangular waveguide, and total internal reflection takes place for the wave. So after that, again it falls on, suppose it is getting reflected from the upper wall, then it falls on the lower wall, then again total internal reflection takes place for the wave, then again it falls on the upper wall. So in this way, finally it reaches to the other end. Now, the direction of wave propagation through the rectangular waveguide, we consider that it is z direction. So if it is an incident wave, it is taken as a positive z direction. If it is a reflected ray, it is taken as a negative z direction. Now, what about this end? So we know the characteristics of electromagnetic wave, that electromagnetic wave is always associated with electric field as well as magnetic field. And this electric and magnetic field are perpendicular to the direction of propagation. Now here, if the wave is propagating in this direction, that is z direction, then the direction which are transverse to this z direction are x direction and y direction. So we can have electric field either existing in this x direction or existing in this y direction. Now, one more characteristics of electromagnetic wave also tells that the electric field and magnetic field are perpendicular to each other. That means when we have electric field in x direction, the magnetic field is going to exist only in y direction, not in x direction. Okay? So, the broader side, usually the broader side of the cross-sectional area is taken as x-axis, and the narrower side is taken as the y-axis. So this is a rectangular waveguide. Similarly, you can use coaxial cable in your network. The coaxial cable, the best example is very simple. The CRO probe or signal generator probe is a coaxial cable. So in microwave network, we use this transmission line. Then comes to the devices. Which are the devices that we are going to use in microwave network? We are going to use attenuators, resonators, filters, and amplifiers. Now there are two terms which are coming in the microwave network. One is a junction. Now what is a junction? So junction is the point of intersection of two or more signals, devices, components, circuits, or modules. Now, for that, I'll show you this device. You can see, you can take that this is the point of intersection of one rectangular waveguide which is coming like this and another rectangular waveguide which is coming like this. So, this is the point of junction. So, this can be taken as a junction. It is the intersection between this waveguide and this waveguide. So, this is a junction. So, at this point, the waves which are carried through this rectangular waveguide and through this rectangular waveguide are also going to intersect. The device is going to intersect. The waves are also going to intersect. So this point is known as a junction. Similarly, next, port. Now, what is a port? Port is a reference plane transverse to the length of microwave transmission line or waveguide. Now, if I see the transmission line, or this is the rectangular waveguide, this is my length. Okay, this is the length. Now, what is port? Port is transverse to the length of the microwave transmission line. So, if I'm considering my length in z direction, then the port is transverse to this, means it exists in the x and y direction. So, this area, what you can see, it is known as the port. Okay, so this side, it is one port, and this side we are getting one. Okay, so these are certain things which are used in a microwave network. When you will come practically, we will design all these microwave networks with all these devices and with all this transmission line. Now, question comes, what is the difference between this network with respect to the normal network? Now, in normal network, as we discussed, we have at the input voltage, current. Similarly, at the output also voltage, current. But when you are seeing a microwave network, you can see that the microwave network is not associated with voltage and current. Rather, it is associated with waves. So, which type of waves we have here? So, we have here the incident wave, which is given as A1, and if we have a mismatch in impedance at this junction, that is the mismatch in impedance means which impedance? Now, when the wave is carried through the transmission line is having characteristics impedance Z0, and when it is delivered to the device, at the input of the device, we have certain impedance which is given by the device or the input impedance of the device. So, if the characteristics impedance is not matching to the input impedance of the device, then we are going to have certain difference, certain reflection in the wave. Okay, so the condition is that if Z0 is not equal to ZI. ZI is the input impedance associated with the two-port network. Then what we are going to have? We are going to have a mismatch condition. And in the mismatch condition, we are going to have reflection. Okay. So this reflection is going to be seen, or we are showing this reflection as B1. At port 1, we are showing it as B1. Now, how much wave is going to be reflected? That completely depends on how much impedance mismatch is there. Okay. So percentage of match mismatching in the impedance. Now, according to that, maybe the complete signal or a part of the signal is going to be reflected. Right. Now, here, when we want to consider what is the power delivered in this two-port device or in this two-port network, so we have to consider the incident power. The incident power is dependent on the incident wave, which is A1. The A1 is the amplitude of the incident wave, and the reflected wave, which is associated with the reflected the reflected power, which is associated with the reflected wave, that is B1. Okay. Now, with these two power knowledge, we can have our transmitted power, with the net transmitted power through the device is going to be the incident power minus the reflected. So, question comes. As a normal network, we have used the Z parameter, Y parameter, H parameter, and ABCD parameter. Can we analyze this microwave network using the same parameter? The answer is no. Why? There are certain reasons. You would have seen while doing the Z parameter, Y parameter, all those things. So one of the port, usually either we make it a short circuit or we make it an open circuit in order to find out the value of voltage and current. But remember, in a microwave network, it is not so easy to make it as an open circuit and short circuit and to calculate certain voltage and current. So basically, there is no availability of terminal voltage and current measuring equipment in a microwave network. Short circuit and open circuit are not achieved for a wide range of frequency. In a microwave network, we cannot do that. Okay. And the other point is presence of active devices makes the circuit unstable for short or open circuit. The question comes, how to analyze a microwave network? Now, in a microwave network, we saw there are discontinuities. Discontinuities due to the devices connected, discontinuities due to the mismatch of the impedance. Now, because of that, the wave gets scattered. The incident wave gets scattered and we get the reflected wave. Now, if we can find a relationship between this incident wave and reflected wave, that is represented as S parameter. So, in a microwave network, we are going to use a new parameter which gives us a relationship between the amplitude of incident wave and reflected wave, and that parameter is S parameter. Okay. Now, coming for the next topic, that is the symmetrical Z and Y matrices for a reciprocal network. So, we have to prove that the Z and Y matrices are symmetrical for a reciprocal network. Now, before starting this, I would like to tell you or explain you what is one reciprocal network. So, as the definition gives, we can do one reciprocal network and we can analyze it. We can do one reciprocal network and analyze. So, reciprocal network, to do one reciprocal network, we can take a two-port device. Okay, we can take a two-port device. Now, what it gives you is a network is said to be reciprocal if the voltage appearing at port 2. Now, let me take this side as port 1. Okay, for this reciprocal network, let me take this side as port 1 and this side as port 2. then what it gives you is the voltage appearing at port 2. So if we have a voltage appearing at port 2 V, okay, due to a current applied at port 1. So let me show that the current applied in port 1 is I1 and this voltage is V2. So if we are getting a voltage at port 2 due to current I1, it is going to be same as the voltage appearing at port 1 when the same current is applied to port 2. That means when we apply current I1 at port 1 and we get a voltage V2, if we interchange them and if we apply a current here, the same current I1, then the voltage which is going to appear at port 1, that is at this point, is going to be same. So you can interchange. So what I mean to say is, if I'm taking my I1 at port 1, V2 as port 2, then I can tell my V2 by I1 is going to be same as if I'm taking V2 at port 1 and I1 at port 2. So this ratio remaining same. So this is a reciprocal network. Okay. Now what we have to prove in a reciprocal network? The Z and Y matrices are symmetrical. Now for that, what we have to prove at the end, we have to prove that Z12 is going to be equal to Z21 and Y12 is going to be equal to Y21. For that, let us consider one N-port network. So N port network means it has N number of ports. Very simple, a network. Let us consider a network which is having N number of ports. So more than 2 ports we are considering. Suppose we have N number of ports. Now out of this N number of ports, if I'm considering some of the ports, so we have the incident voltage given as Vn plus, where this N shows the number of the, means that which port, that particular port's number, and Vn minus shows the reflected wave. So in this way, suppose the total number of ports that we have in this N port network is N. So N gives us the number of ports that we are going to have, the total number of ports. Now, we have like this condition. So at any port, if we want to find what is the total voltage, so total voltage Vn is equal to Vn plus the incident voltage plus Vn minus the reflected voltage. Or rather, I'll tell it because it is a microwave network. So rather, let me tell, it is my incident wave and my reflected wave, which gives me my total net. Now let us take a condition. At any port, this value of Vn is equal to 0. But there are 2 ports, which is a ith port and which one is a jth port. So we are considering ith port and jth port. At these 2 ports, we have electric field EIE and HIE at the ith port. And similarly, at the jth port, we have electric field EJ and HJ. So in these 2 ports, we cannot have Vn equal to 0. So in these 2 ports, we don't have Vn equal to 0 because there is one existence of electric field and magnetic field. So at EI port and at EJ port, at ith port and at jth port, we have the voltage which is not equal to 0. Now, according to Lorentz reciprocity theorem, if you are taking Lorentz reciprocity theorem, then we can write that EI, so the electric field at ith port, so that is my EI cross multiplied by HJ, okay, over the surface area of the junction. So S gives me the surface area of the junction where I have my port 1 and port 2 are joined to the device. If I'm taking EI minus into cross product of EI and HJ minus cross product of EJ into HI, if we are taking it, so this value is going to be zero according to Lorentz reciprocity theorem. Okay, so where S is my enclosed surface area of the conducting walls enclosing the junction. Okay, the surface area of the conducting walls enclosing the junction. Now, if I have total number of ports, as I have told, is capital N, then the summation of all the electric and magnetic fields over all the ports, where the ports number starts from 1 to N, if we take the summation of all the ports, so obviously the value is going to, according to Lorentz reciprocity theorem, so this value is going to be equal to 0. Now, what we have here, so we have to consider the total electric field that we are going to have. So the total electric field in this condition, if you are taking at the ith port, is equal to N into EI. Okay. If similarly, if N is my number of ports, similarly, the total electric field at the jth port can be N into EJ. Okay, so using the same equation, what we can write it, if we are taking the total electric field, so we can write the equation is something like this, where I'll consider my all the ith port, so total electric field or the power of all the ith port, which is given as EI into HJ, okay, is going to be equal to all the power at the jth ports, which is going to be given as EJ into HI. Okay, so this gives me the power at ith port, okay, power at the reference plane I, due to the input given at input voltage at port J. Okay, so this gives me PIJ, gives me the power at ith port, power at plane I, due to the voltage applied, the applied voltage at jth port, plane J, we can write. So this is our PIJ. Similarly, PJI also can be taken as the power at plane J due to the voltage applied at port I. If we are taking, then from the cross product of EI into HJ, we can write this is nothing but PIJ is equal to PJI. We know the cross product of electric field and magnetic field, it gives us the power. Now, if we consider the Y parameter, then very well we can write the Y parameter for any network is equal to I into I is equal to Y into V. Now, in this equation, in the above equation for PIJ and PJI, if I'll replace for PIJ, so that is equal to VI into IJ is equal to VJ into II. Okay. Now, again, let us substitute for current in this equation, IJ and II. Let us substitute for IJ and II. So IJ is equal to, we can write it as VJ into YIJ, which is equal to VJ. And for II, we can substitute it equal to VI into YJI. I. Okay. Now canceling the like terms. VI, VI gets cancelled. VJ, VJ gets cancelled. So we are getting YIJ is equal to YJI. Okay. Similarly, we can calculate for the Z parameter. Once we have got the Y parameter, we can write for Z parameter. ZIJ is equal to ZJI. So this gives us a relationship for the Y parameter and Z parameter in a reciprocal network, and it proves that the Y parameter and Z parameters of a reciprocal network are symmetrical in nature. So these equations we will be using further when we'll study the properties of S matrix, and further when we'll study a comparison between S matrix and Y and Z matrix. So that's all for today's class. In next class, we'll be discussing regarding the S matrix, and we will try to find out the properties of S matrix. Thank you. Meet you soon.